All right, well, good morning. So good to see everyone. So took the last two Sundays off. We went on vacation. We went camping up in northern Minnesota. So we went to Lake Itasca and Lake Bemidji. And I always wanted to go there because I grew up in Clinton and the Comanche area in Iowa on the Mississippi and spent many time, you know, along the river. And I wanted to see where the headwaters were. So we got to go see that. So that was just a wonderful time. So it was good to spend some time away and to enjoy it. So I want to say thank you to everyone who covered for me and made that possible. So this is the day the Lord has made.
Let's rejoice and be glad in
it. Amen. Well, let's do that together as we stand and sing our opening hymn this morning, O for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. We'll just do till verse 5, even though I think all 7 are on there, but we'll just do to verse 5.
For a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumph of His grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of thy name. Jesus, the name that charms our fears, that bids our sorrows cease, 'tis music in the sinner's ears, 'tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of cancel sin, He sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean. His blood avail for me. He speaks and listening to His voice, new life the dead receive. The mournful broken hearts rejoice, the humble poor believe.
Thank you, Terry, for playing, and welcome back, Carter. Okay, is there anybody else has any announcements or joys or concerns they would like to share with us today? I'll get you.
I'd just like to thank everybody for the prayers that you're doing for Jack. He's just not feeling good enough to come today. When he came last week, we weren't here 5 minutes, and he had to take his shirt off. He's having one of his hot flashes, and after he takes his painkillers, then he gets headaches from them, and it's just really, really uncomfortable for him. So I appreciate your concern. Thank you. If anyone's available to serve coffee, the next 3 Sundays are open.
I'd simply like to inform everybody, in behalf of the Northwood Lions Club, we're having a blood drive on Thursday of this week. It starts at 1:00 and concludes at 5:30, but it is in a different location. The location now is at the community room at the fairgrounds. It'll be clearly marked, so if you can give blood, please do so, because I'll be honest with you, as maybe you read in the paper, every single 2 seconds we need, or every 2 seconds in this country, a pint of blood is needed in this country. So it's there. And One pint of blood can save as many as three lives. Now, to be perfectly honest with you, some of it is used for research, but the need is still great. I think, as I indicated in the newspaper this week, the greatest gift you can give to somebody is your blood.
Is there anyone else? Okay, Pastor, I guess that's it.
Okay. So, in case you can't smell it, we have a potato bar after church this morning, and what that is, it's to raise money. Carter and I are going to go and join a group from Emmons and other youth and adults from across Iowa as a part of the NALC. They have what they call their Iowa Mission District, and so each year they do a trip somewhere that's like a mission service project. And so this year we're going to go to Port Charlotte, Florida, to help with the cleanup efforts from Hurricane Ian this last year. And it just so happens that Asbury, there was a couple from Florida that lived near Tampa that were there. And I mentioned that, like, oh yeah, it's really bad down there still. So there's a lot of work yet to be done. So Carter and I, and there's going to be 66 of us total, are going to leave on July 23rd and spend a week down there and doing whatever they need. Probably do some painting, maybe hang some drywall or do some cleanup, whatever it is. They have all this set up. They just need people to come and volunteer. So that's what we're doing. So the money's going to go towards that. So I hope you're hungry. All right, well, let's stand as we continue our service. We'll do our hymn of praise, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. And we trials and temptations. Can we find a friend so faithful, who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Still our refuge, take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? Take it to the Lord in prayer. He'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find a solace there.
So, Carl. Christ calls those who are weary and heavy laden.
In Christ we find rest.
And Christ calls us to bear his yoke and learn from him.
And in Christ we see God's ways.
Christ is gentle and humble in heart.
And in Christ we know God's love.
So come, for Christ calls us here. Oh, you have walked many miles with us, O God. You have comforted and strengthened us along the way. Keep us on your path, for we easily lose our way. As we learn to live in your ways, help us choose the cause of justice and righteousness. Amen. Now, Lord, be with you. Let's take a moment or two to greet one another this morning.
Good morning. Morning.
Well, join me now, if you will, in our offertory response and prayer.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.
God, may these gifts celebrate your name among the nations, and may the lives we live celebrate your name for all time and all generations. Receive these offerings as signs of our praise, both now and forevermore. Amen. You may be seated.
The scripture reading this morning is from the New Testament, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 11, verses 16 through 19 and 25 through 30. To what will I compare this generation? It is like a child sitting in the marketplaces calling out to others. We played the flute for you and you didn't dance. We sang a funeral song and you didn't mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say he has a demon. Yet the human one came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunk, a friend of tax collectors and sinners, but wisdom is proved to be right by her works. At that time, Jesus said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you've hidden these things from the wise and intelligent and have shown them to babies. Indeed, Father, this brings you happiness. My Father has handed all things over to me. No one knows the Son except the Father, and nobody knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wants to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are struggling hard and carrying heavy loads, and I will give you rest. Put on my yoke and learn from me. I'm gentle and humble, and you will find rest for yourselves. My yoke is easy to bear, and my burden is light. The sermon text is taken from the book of Romans, chapter 7, verses 15 through 25a. I don't know what I'm doing because I don't do what I want to do. Instead, I do the thing that I hate. But if I'm doing the thing that I don't want to do, I'm agreeing that the law is right. But now I'm not the one doing it anymore. Instead, it's sin that lives in me. I know that good doesn't live in me, that is, in my body. Desire to do good is inside of me, but I can't do it. Desire to do good is inside of me, but I can't do it, but I don't do the good that I want to do, but I do the evil that I don't want to do. But if I do the very thing that I don't want to do, then I'm not the one doing it anymore. Instead, it is sin that lives in me that is doing it. So I find that as a rule. When I want to do what is good, evil is right there with me. I gladly agree with the law on the inside, but I see a different law at work in my body. It wages a war against the law of my mind and takes me prisoner with the law of sin that is in my body. I'm a miserable human being. Who will deliver me from this dead corpse? Thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then I'm a slave to God's law in my mind, but I'm a slave to sin's law in my body. Here ends the reading.
All right, thank you, Karen. So, when we hear these words from the Apostle Paul in the book of Romans that Karen read, and I don't know, can you relate to that saying where Paul says, I don't do the things that I want to do, instead I do the things that I hate? So he's talking about this struggle inside, this fight between like good and evil. So I like this illustration of these two wolves. So you have the lighter wolf and the dark wolf, so the light and the darkness, and it says, who will win? Well, it's the one you feed, right? That's the one that will win. So do we all know the expression hangry? We've heard that before. Basically what it is, it's you take hungry and angry and you put them together and you get hangry. I've been known to suffer from this according to Melinda and Hannah and Carter. They tell me this often. And it's this idea that there's this strange connection between hunger and anger. And I can feel it come on, I get irritated easily. It's like the slightest thing like kind of sets me off, and they're like, are you okay? You need to eat something? I'm like, yeah, I think I do. It's like that Snickers commercial where they're like, dude, you need to eat this. You're not yourself. Eat something. And it's amazing. It makes a difference. So which are we feeding? We let ourselves like go hungry and we have this ravenous like almost thing inside of us, or are we feeding the light? So let me tell you that it's a real thing, and the struggle is real. Are we trying to starve something or quit something? man, there's like this hunger that comes out of it. It's like we desire and crave these things we never normally would. And it's like it becomes the forefront of our mind. Well, I want to look at this idea of this fight inside and how we can overcome this struggle. So first off, it's a delusion to think that when someone becomes a Christian, that immediately all our desires and temptations to sin are gone. It's a delusion to think that. Because it's still there. It doesn't immediately get removed. No, they're still there, but here's the good news. We don't have to be a slave to them. Listen to 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, they're a new creation. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things become new. So it's like referring to this born-again experience. When we talk about being born again, that's what it means. You're not the same person. Yes, you're still you, but that old you that has the tendency to sin, has a tendency to do evil because of original sin, that's gone. That's not there. We're no longer a slave to that. And we can choose then to say no to those because of the power of Jesus in us. Now, does that mean that sin's totally eradicated? No. It'd be nice, wouldn't it? But it's not. It's not totally eradicated from us. The struggle is there. It's like when Paul was talking about, again, in verse 17 and 18. But now, I'm not the one doing it anymore. Instead, it's sin that lives in me. I know that good doesn't live in me, that is, in my body. The desire to do good is inside of me, but I can't do it. See, that power of sin is great. I don't think we give that enough credit, like, to heed that evil is a very much a powerful force, and I don't think we give that enough credence. There's a war being waged, fighting against it, but we can overcome it. Now, is there any way that we can defeat it? No. Is there any way that we can break from it, free from it in our own strength? No. No. But thanks be to God, we don't have to. Amen? Thanks be to God, we don't have to do it on our own strength because we'd fall short every time. It's Christ who lives in us that helps us in our struggles. So we have the option then to make that right decision. Or to put it a better way, we have the ability to be guided in the right direction. So what is it that helps us? Is that guide? Well, you say it's the law. And so when we talk about the law, we're talking about the law of Moses. So first was the Ten Commandments. Then it was the other laws that God gave to Moses to give to the people. Or for us, it's this, the Bible. That's our guide. So, yes, the Bible does contain the law of Moses, but it also has the teachings of Jesus. We have the writings of the apostles. We have the words of the prophets. We have all these other things along with that to guide us. So whatever situation you're in, whatever you're looking for, you need some advice, let's say, well, I could use some marriage advice. Hey, look at what does the Bible have to say about that? Or, boy, I'm having a hard time parenting. Boy, I need some help there. Hey, what does the Bible say about that? Or if you just need some advice on how to be a good friend, how to be loving and kind to somebody else, man, all kinds of stuff about that right here. But all the great stuff written in the Bible is only as good as if we actually read it and then apply it. Yeah. If all this book does is sit on our shelf, doesn't do much good. No, we need to get from here into here to read it and apply it. Now, we have the option of totally ignoring what the Bible says. That's an option. We make our own decisions and choices. Now, I don't think that's a good idea. I would advocate against that, but we have that option to say, I really don't give a rip what that says, and I'm going to do whatever. But the Bible, too, It also tells us, besides kind of examples of how to live, tells us about God's great love for us. Man, that no matter what, God loves everyone. No matter who you are, where you come from, or what you've done, God loves us all. And he wishes that none would perish. That's why Jesus had to come. God doesn't want anyone to perish. God didn't want anyone to go to hell. He sent Jesus as to make a way, the way for us. And if we look to Christ, if we come to Jesus, that's the way of salvation. You know, God's not going around with a lightning bolt in each hand, scouring the earth, just waiting for someone to screw up so he can, you know, smote them or smite them. I'm not sure what the right verbiage is there, but you know what I mean? God's not doing that. That's not God's intent. God cares about all of creation. So another way that we can aid in making the right choice, follow the right example, kind of go back to our illustration here, is, are we feeding more of the light or things of God? Or are we feeding more of the darkness? So if we think of our eyes and our ears as input devices, because really that's what they are. They're input devices. So what are the things that we're viewing, watching, reading? What are the things we're listening to? Is that feeding our spirit? Or is it doing the opposite? Now, there's certain shows I enjoy that are very much uplifting and spiritual. And there's other ones that I like to watch too, but I really got to limit myself because I know if I watch too many of them, I feel it having an effect on me. I can feel where it kind of changes me. I'm like, okay, I need to take a break from these things and watch something else. There's one show or genre of things I really enjoy, and that's like gangster movies and TV shows. I really like that, you know, the mob scene and all that stuff. I really get into those. And when the show The Sopranos came out, I really, really wanted to watch that, but it was on HBO. I was like, I'm not paying the extra money for HBO for one show. Then I saw, it came out on video. I was like, oh, great. So I went and rented the first DVD, and I watched the first two episodes, and man, I was hooked. I wanted to watch some more. So Melinda at this time worked nights, and this is before we had Hannah and Carter, obviously. So she'd work 12-hour shifts, and I'd be home by myself. I'm like, what am I going to do? Oh, I'll go to the video store and get something. So I started watching the series, and like I said, I loved the first one. Two episodes, so I got the next couple videos and watched it. Before I knew it, I went through the whole season. Now, you gotta remember, this was before Netflix and those things. This was before the idea of binge-watching a series or a TV show. And before I knew it, man, like 5 hours had passed. And I'm like, oh, I probably should have gotten something else done today. You know, there's laundry I could have done or dishes to wash or lawn to mow or whatever it was. And I'm like, boy, I got to really limit myself. And I knew that I was in trouble this one night. Now, to set this next story up, I got to tell you something else. So we lived in town, and Melinda had beautiful flower beds, and we had this really cool pond that we stocked full of goldfish. Well, all the cats in the neighborhood loved it, too. We didn't have cats, but they loved to come crap in Melinda's flower beds and scruff around and mess with our fish. So we're like, how do we keep these stupid cats out? I know. I'll put up an electric fence. So I got a low impedance electric fence, and instead of putting it, you know, like horizontal, like for cows or whatever, I put it upright because I thought, well, if I got it like this, the cats would just jump over it. So if I had it upright, then that would deter them. And it did. It worked great. The only problem was is when it rained, the water would settle on there, and then it'd start to short out. So you hear like this tss, 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 really loud noise. I'd have to run out and unplug it quick. Otherwise, it worked really good. So I'd been watching The Sopranos. It was one of those summer nights, kind of early on in the summer, when it was warm during the day, but it really cooled off at night. So I had the window open. It was was a nice, calm breeze, and man, I was out. I mean, out cold. And I'm having this dream that I'm like a cop, but not like a good cop. I'm like the bad cop, you know, and I'm interrogating this guy, and he's sitting down across this table from me in his chair. I'm trying to get him to talk, to confess, and he won't do it. So I get angry, and I leap up over the desk, and I grab him, and he's sitting in his chair, and I just start slapping him like this, like slap, 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 like tell me what I need to know, slap, slap, slap. And I wake up, and I hear the electric fence, it must have started to sprinkle, I hear this tss, tss, tss. And so in my mind, that was a slap, and I had this weird dream, and I'm like, oh man, I gotta lay off the Sopranos for a while. So maybe you've experienced something like that where sounds or certain things incorporate in your dreams and it causes you to think, you know, maybe I've been spending too much time on my phone or in front of the screens or other things. Maybe I need a break. I need to do something different. Maybe something a little more uplifting. So in the same way we can, you know, watch stuff that like affects ourselves negatively, we can watch things that affect our spirit positively. So to feed the light, we can listen to some uplifting worship and praise music or other things. Or watch some uplifting shows or read some devotional, spiritual books, other things to kind of do that. So every Sunday when I'm on my way to Lake Mills, I always listen to 106.9, which is KROC. And in the Sunday morning, their program is Straight from the Heart. So they play this like upbeat, you know, contemporary Christian music. So I really love to listen to that. And I find that in listening to that on my way to the church there, by the time I get there, man, I'm kind of pumped. My spirit's like, yeah, man, I'm ready to go. I'm ready. Let's do this. As if I wouldn't have done any of that, and I get to church, and all I'm thinking about is, oh, man, I got to get this done or that done, or I got to work on this or that, and then the service starts, and I'm really not into it, or other things. It's like in the heat of summer, and you get in your car, and it's hot, real hot, and you crank up the air. Is it immediately cold? No. It takes a while. If all you're doing is going to the grocery store, by the time you get there, it may be a little cold, but not really cooled off. As if you were to use the remote start or walk out there and turn on and then get in your car maybe 15 minutes later. Ooh, it's nice and cold and chilled. And it's kind of like that idea. What are we doing? Are we priming our spirit kind of before we come to church? Are we doing those things? Are we reading our devotional maybe before we come? Or listening to some praise and worship music? Getting ourselves primed so then we can actually get the most out of the service while we're here, to hear from God, to experience all that. Or are we too focused on other things that we miss half the service? And what did Pastor Rob say? And fellowship time, all right. And we kind of miss what's happening. So it's the idea of kind of feed our spirit, prime ourselves, get ready to receive what God would want to say to us. The last thing I want to say about all this is don't let struggling with sin somehow make you feel less than as a Christian. Don't let that make you feel like you're not worthy or you're somehow not quite there or you're not where God wants you to be or God's somehow disappointed in you. No, don't fall into that. Because if you read on in Romans, to the next chapter, the first two verses say this, Romans 8, 1 and 2. So now there isn't any condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. So when God looks at us, you know what God sees? It's not the things we don't like about ourselves. It's not the things we wish we could change or we feel like maybe our ugliness or stuff we don't want anyone else to know. God doesn't see any of that. You know what God sees? He sees Christ Jesus that's inside of us. When God looks at us, he says, you know what I see? Good. What does it say when he was done with all of creation in Genesis? God looked around at everything he made and he said, it is good. It is good. You are a beloved son and daughter of God. I hope you hear that this morning. Don't let guilt, condemnation, all these other things make you feel anything less than that. Because we've been set free. And it's the grace of God that allows us to say no to sin and yes to more of God. Amen? Amen. Amen. Well, join me, if you will, then in our communion liturgy this morning. So the Lord be with you. So lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
So it is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. And when we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Well, holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. And by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, he gave birth to your church and delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, and he broke the bread, gave it to his disciples as he said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you and gave it to his disciples as he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we proclaim this mystery of faith, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. So pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here, now these gifts of the bread and of the cup. May they be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And so with the confidence of the children of God, let us say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Well, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, take, eat. It will do you good. So as you come, I'll give you the bread, and we have the cup at the rail. And if you want to kneel, feel free to kneel. If you want to spend some time in just contemplation, feel free to do that as well.
Of ages, cleft for me, let me hide. myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flowed be of sin the double cure. Say from
So in remembrance is how we're to do this as we partake of communion. So this song is about that. So stand with me as we sing the song in remembrance of me.
in remembrance of me. Eat this bread in remembrance of me. Drink this wine in remembrance of me. Pray for the time when God's own will is done. In remembrance of me, heal the sick. In remembrance of me, feed the poor. In remembrance of me,
go forth with the confidence of Rebecca, who left everything behind to follow God, and go forth with the delight of Paul, who felt freedom to follow Christ, and go forth with the joy of the Holy Spirit, who dances with praise throughout creation. So before we sing our last song, I just want to say a blessing to you on our meal, and invite everyone to stick around and join us for that. So let's bless our food. Well, God, thank you for everyone who helped to provide for this, and we ask that you just bless this food and that the funds will go to help do the most good and just showing and advancing your love and the spread of your kingdom. Amen.
Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Let not your heart be troubled. His tender word I hear, and resting on his goodness, I lose my doubts and fears. Though by eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Whenever I am tempted, whenever clouds arise, when song gives place to sighing, when hope within me dies, I draw the closer to him. From care he sets me free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know